Greetings. I'm gonna go to a party real soon, but my hair needs to dry, so I thought I would just do a quick chat about Murakami. Here I have the Kafka on the Shore and Norwegian Wood, where Kafka on the Shore is Norwegian, Norwegian Wood is in English. Yes, I've talked a lot about Murakami, but I think that there's a lot to say about Murakami. When I was reading this, when I was reading Norwegian Wood, I was in a park and this British guy comes and asks me for a cigarette, and he sees I'm reading Murakami and he recommended me this book. And what was it called? I wrote it down. He saw I was reading Norwegian Wood and he said that I had to check out this other book called From Hiding Karakami, Strange Weather in Tokyo. So this is that he recommended me that book because it's also by a Japanese author, and he says there's something about Japanese authors that their style of writing is very simple. Now, despite my past as a weeboo, I don't think I've ever read a book, a different Japanese author that's like an actual book, and not just like a manga. So I don't know if that is true. There's something about the language that makes the translation feels simpler in a way, or more clean. But I do think that Murakami writes very simple and clean cut. But yeah, I think when I did the Norwegian Wood book review, I talked about why he's so easy to read. But I kind of forgot a couple of points. I need to drink my Baileys because this is a four spill. I need. He's not only easy to read because I talk about the symbolism and how like it's really neat that the characters have like two traits that are really easy to define, and symbolism that keeps reoccurring very obviously. Well, it's very blatant, while in other books it's more hidden. That there's like, oh, this is like a little sign of this. So that makes it easy. But what another thing is like the mystery. There's always this kind of mystery and always a new thing. So I don't actually think it's very chill. Like there's always this mood of melancholy, and maybe that's why. But I don't think it's a very exciting. He doesn't write very exciting books. Like there's a mystery, and from the get-go, there's always a mystery that keeps you intrigued and keeps you reading, makes it easy to read because you have the motivation, because you're like, what's going on? While other books are like, you kind of, the mystery appears later, or there's no mystery, and you just care about the characters and stuff like that. But here, there's always like, what's going on? And sometimes, and often you don't get answers, but I think that he does that really well too. Like, because usually I hate books who just like doesn't give you any answer at the end. But I think that he actually does. Like, there's some things that happens that aren't answers a lot. It's like, what's going on? But he still makes it work. But what I wanted to say was, there's so much to say, so I just keep jabbering on. I think that it's not very exciting. It's not like, oh, what's gonna happen next? Like, there's no, like, that's what I hated about 1Q84, because that was like a really long book too. I read it. I don't know if it's considered a book or a trilogy, because sometimes I see like you have everything in one, and I read like, I think I read the first book and then like the second and third, so I don't know if it's called one book or it's three books. But anyway, it was pretty long, and when I thought it was a trilogy. And even though like you can spend more time, the thing is, the excitement was kind of, it was a very slow build. What I missed in IQ84, I mean, you could take this as a spoiler, but I'm not gonna say anything about what happens. Just like no, nothing. I'm not gonna say anything about what happens in the book. Just like talk like above it. What I missed was, you have three books. Maybe it's only one book, but you have three books. Let's just assume it's like three books. And even though it's a trilogy, you can still have the excitement. I don't know the English word. Oh no, the excitement point. That's like the highest point. You know how you're supposed to build up what's happening, and then boom, everything is going crazy. And then it like calms down, and like even though it's a trilogy, I feel like that never really happened until the end of the very last one, and I kind of wished it was did like this, because I wanted to have like this really exciting part in both the first and second book, but there wasn't really, so that made me almost give up on it, or I kind of put it down for like a week after I read like the first and second, and then I was like, it's just the same thing. But I mean, I still love the book, and I realized how much, that's another thing about Murakami, is how I realized how much I like the books after. I thought I didn't like Kafka on the Shore that much, or did I? I know that when it IQ84, I was like, wow, I thought I didn't like this book when I was reading it, but now that I'm not, I'm like, is this it? Like, I was so drawn into the universe. It was just so interesting and so fun, and it's just like so exciting, and then suddenly I'm like, what? So, and I think just that feeling I had when I finished the book, the feeling of just, what now? I mean, wow, I was like totally lost in the book, and that's the thing, I just completely fell into the book, even though it wasn't really that exciting and that disappointed me, but I fell into it, which is why I realized, wow, that was a really good book, or books. And then with Kafka on the Shore too, I was like, oh wow, that was actually, now that I'm thinking back on it, I'm like, I totally forgot the whole side story thing, or I kind of forgot that they were part of Kafka on the Shore, because there's like, oh, it's often like, and I just didn't remember those characters. The side story was in that book. I thought it was in IQ84, and I was just like, they're so funny. I loved, especially, there's always, I feel like there's always one character in the Murakami book. Who's my favorite characters? I think my favorite characters, I liked, oh, I don't remember, what's the librarian, I liked the librarian, oh, I was totally hyped, and I was like, what, there's a trans person, and, like, the trans person was even, like, I'm not gonna say this, that was kind of a spoiler. I mean, you find out really early in the book, so it's not a spoiler. And also, which book was I talking about? Anyway, I really like that character. And I think, and there's a lot of, and in other books too. Which one? You would never know, because I've read several of his books. But in one book, there's more LGBT stuff going on. And that's also, like, refreshing, because there's often not, so I think it's also just great, because that's not like the main focus. I do think it's really, really great. It's great that people, especially LGBT writers, are like, let's focus on writing LGBT books for LGBT people. But I also love how but at the same time, Murakami is just really weird when it comes to sexual intercourse. Like, what's the deal? I feel like I need to make an entire separate video on, like, his... I mean, I remember I was really, really shocked at the start, because I was like, this dude, he's into some weird stuff, huh? But that would be very spoilery. Assuming that there's someone who's like, now you can be like, what is going on now? I have to read Murakami, because you're like, what? Why are you so taken aback by the PG-18 stuff. Is it 18? PG-16 maybe. Or maybe it depends on the country. I don't know. But yeah, I think I just want to keep talking, but this is already 10 minutes, so I think I'm gonna stop. But yeah, Murakami is easy to read, except for 184, which I think it was still easy, but it was just like it didn't have like the reason why Murakami is easy is because it's very exciting, and then but then it's always like the excitement. These books are always like it's very chill excitement. It's not like what's gonna happen. It's like wow, I wonder. This is very interesting. So it's like, and that works when his books are like Norwegian Wood was like 400 pages long, but it doesn't really work when you have a longer book like 184, because then it's like, come on dude, something's gonna happen. But it was such a good book. I miss the main character so much. That was like, there's some scenes that I have, you know, like he just writes so beautifully sometimes, like sometimes it is too simple. I will admit sometimes it's a bit like, I mean, I do think that he's like the better version of John Green, but that was at least what I felt. Now I feel more about him, but now I really have learned to appreciate how like he's just setting the mood in his book. Like there's some scenes that I can just visually see them so well. Like he's just really, really painted the picture. Like there's a couple of things, like when I think of 184, there's like this one scene in the book that is just like, whoa. And even at the very, very start, I could just picture that, the very start of the book, like so well. And it was really, really cool, because usually I just feel like, yeah, usually it's more difficult to picture, but for him it's like so obvious, like this. Yeah, because I've been that's a good point. I'm like learning more about how I view Murakami with talking about it, because like usually when I read books it's like, oh yeah, this is happening, I'll try to kind of think of what it looks like, but really there's like a couple of things that I really picture. But for Murakami it's like just so strong, the feeling of like he tells you what it looks like and then you really, really sees it, which is so cool. But anyway, maybe I should read more Murakami, but now I read everything that I wanted to, and now I'm like, I think maybe the Wind Up Bird Chronicles, maybe I should read that. That looks kind of interesting, but I don't know. Because I really like Murakami, like he's so chill, like I can really relax, I know I should have been reading Desolation Angels by Kerouac, but it's difficult, and it's like, I didn't know it would be the part of his life where he's like up at the mountain, and he's just like reflecting, and it's like kind of boring. Like he's talking about like, this is about Murakami, so I'll talk shit about Kerouac a different time, but and I think that if I hadn't read, I would have been so confused if I hadn't read Maggie Cassidy, or like basically like just knew everything about his life before reading Desolation Angel. So if you want to read Kerouac, like, and also Dharma Bums, but so don't start on Desolation Angels, because I'm pretty sure I would have been hella confused, or at least I would have not been able to appreciate it as much, because he's like talking about like throwbacks all the time, and it's like, okay, this is kind of interesting, because like I've read an entire book about these two pages, but it's still like, I didn't like The Subterranean's first 30 pages too, and I really like that book, so maybe I need to just keep going at it. Maybe I should read now, and then my hair will be dry. Yeah, this is still wet. I just read, my hair will be dry, and I can leave. Some of my friends have a new apartment that I'm, so. And it's Saturday evening. My friend never showed, so I'm making videos about books. Oh, that was lame. Yeah. Maybe I should call her too. Okay, anyway, this video is done, and the last 5 minutes was kind of unnecessary, I think. Maybe, I don't know. Anyway, love Murakami. Gotta fight my way through some more Kerouac now, because I do love him, but it's also tiring, and maybe I should have started on Tom Wolfe's drug. I don't know. What's the name? Kool-Aid. Electric Kool-Aid acid tests or something. Yeah, but I feel bad for my project. My project was supposed to be Kerouac, and I just keep reading other books. But Crime and Punishment was so good, and I realized I should have worn my Crime and Punishment sweater when making the book review thingy. But I was so tired. Okay, bye.